Hey, good morning, Peace Tower. It's this crazy weather in Ottawa. So good to see you this morning. It's Tuesday morning, and I believe it's April the 21st. Isn't it interesting how these days just keep running into each other? Man, I'll tell you, I wake up in the morning, and some days I don't know what day it is. But I know that we're in April, and we're moving forward. So anyways, it's good to have you with us online. Just working through some technical difficulties. You know, they're changing stuff all the time on us with YouTube and Facebook. And so we are so happy that you are joining with us every morning, and hopefully that you're getting a lot out of these devotionals. You know, we've entered into our seventh week that we haven't been meeting, but we've been meeting online, and we're going forward, and we trust that you're being helped and you're being blessed by these live stream videos. And yeah, we're just going to keep going. That's all we can do, and keep going, keep trusting God. You know, we say all the time that the church is still alive. It's not shut down. But I hope that you're doing well this morning, and I hope that you're healthy and well. And we hear on the news that we've had a curve over the last couple of days and sort of plateaued the COVID-19 virus. So we're excited about that, and we're praying that hopefully it will be done soon and we can get back together. You know, we're meeting as a staff, and we're talking about those very areas that hopefully that within the next several weeks, by the middle of May, that they'll allow us to start coming back together. And we're just starting to strategize what's that going to look like. You know, we're not sure how many people they're going to allow us to have in a meeting. So maybe they'll let us have 20 or 25. So thinking about maybe going to house churches around the city, in this great city of Ottawa, or maybe going to multiple services. But keep praying with us. We believe that God's going to help us, and he's going to lead us as we move forward. So good to see Ron listening with us this morning. And I see Helen and Jake are jumping online, and we're just going to wait till several people jump online, and hopefully you'll be blessed again this morning, as you always are. Wasn't that a great message Sunday morning, Pastor Jerome? Pastor, I was in the sanctuary when he preached that message, and you know, we're going to miss Jerome and Victoria. They have been a great blessing here at Peace Tower Church, but we know that they're in God's hands. We know that they're excited about this new adventure that they're going to, and so we just bless them. And we want you to know that for you that are remaining here with us, that we have good leadership. Pastor Himali, I'm calling her Pastor Himali now, because that's what she is. She's taking over our children's ministry, our youth ministry, and she'll be working with all the young people. And then Pastor Mike and Ann are going to be taking over our young adult ministry, and we're excited about that, and I know that they will be a great blessing in that adult ministry. So yeah, I see Cynthia's jumped on, and we just welcome you today, and others are coming on board. So lots of good things. You know, another thing I want to remind you about is that we're here every morning, and we want you to get a hold of us. Hopefully you've joined our text messaging contact. And if you haven't, you can go to our website, www.peacetowerchurch.com, and you'll see how you can contact us there. And we want to know what's going on. And so if you are maybe feeling a little discouraged, maybe you're feeling a little shut in, we would like to hear from you so we could be a blessing and maybe give you a call. We're working on that, calling our people every week. And it was so good to talk to some of our folks this week on the phone, and really enjoyed talking to people and finding out how they're doing and what's going on in their lives. So you go to our website, www.peacetowerchurch.ca, not .com, .ca. I've been in the States too long. And you'll find out how you can contact us there. And I know we will get connected, and it should be a good time. Also, we also want to remind you, not only are we meeting every day at 11 o'clock, but we want to thank you for your continued giving. And we like to put in a little reminder because we know Sunday has passed and several of you have already given online through Interact Transfer. And maybe today, I know you can get out of the habit of writing out that check or giving that tithe. And we want you to know that our people are staying up and they're helping us. I would have never dreamed that going into 7 weeks that we would be, you know, the Lord is with us. And we're not that bad off financially. God has helped us and people are continuing to give. And we just want to thank you for that. It means a lot to us here at Peace Tower Church as a staff as we are working hard through this pandemic and we're trying to meet the needs of our congregation. I said to my wife the other day, I think I'm working harder now than I ever have because there's a lot of new technology that I have to learn, learning how to do these Zoom meetings and how to do them well. And I thank God for our staff, Pastor Mike and Sophie, who've really helped me and bringing this this old dog up to speed in the 21st century. And so, yeah, lots of good stuff going on. And we want to stay connected and we want to stay busy and working, not to the point that we're overworked, but to the point that we're ministering to God's people. And so we want to thank you from the bottom of our heart for your continued giving. And we pray that hopefully that we'll be together soon again. So God bless you. You know, I got a word for you this morning. And I want to talk to you about being made in the image of God. And I was thinking about this week as I sort of getting ready, as people were coming on, I was getting ready for my week. And I was just thinking about how God works in our lives. You know, when I was a kid, I grew up in a town called Belleville, Ontario. Some of you know where it is. It's about halfway between Ottawa and Toronto on the 401. And I remember growing up as a kid, I used to love this time of year because it was a time of year that my buddies and I, we would go way up the Moira River. If you've ever been down through Corbyville and Canifton and Belleville, there's this river called the Moira, and it runs out of the north. It probably runs for about 75 miles. And we would go up there in the spring of the year and we would make these homemade rafts. It was a hoot because the deal, the goal was the first guy down the river in the spring on his raft won the prize. Now, there was not a prize. It was just bragging rights is what it was. And so we would go up the river. And I remember this. I don't know why I'm thinking about this week, but we would go up the river and there'd be maybe four, five, six of us, and we'd make these rafts. You had to make your own raft by the wood that was there that you could find, and you'd wrap the binder twine around, and you'd take nails and hammers, and by the time we got to the end of the river, every one of us were soaking wet. And you know what the river's like in April. It's cold. It's a wonder that one of us didn't drown. But it was a lot of fun growing up in Belleville, Ontario as a kid. And yet I was thinking about that also that, you know, when I was growing up in my life, there were a lot of insecurities that I had in my life. And I loved sports and I loved being outdoors. But I wasn't a real good athlete. I wasn't a bad athlete. And I loved to play hockey and I played baseball, played a little football in high school. But I didn't excel at any sport in particular. And when I was growing up, there were some insecurities that I had in my life. And like most of us growing up, you know, we all have dysfunctional families, I'm sure. And everybody has an uncle or an aunt that is probably dysfunctional in some way or another. And I remember when I came into my teen years that those insecurities really started to rise up in my life, and they were coming in and areas of my life that I wasn't happy with, and I went out to Bible school in Peterborough, and when I was in Bible school through that first year, those insecurities were still there, and I was really questioning my call. I was questioning whether God wanted me in the ministry. And to make a long story short, in 1976, after our first year of Bible school, five of us went up into the Northwest Territories. And we were up in the Hay River. And if any of you have been around the Assemblies of God, Pentecostal Assemblies of Canada long enough, we had a hospital there in the Hay River. And they were adding on to the hospital. So five of us went up there that summer. And I didn't know what I was going to do. I didn't know if I was going to go back to Bible college. I didn't know if I was really called to the ministry. I had a lot of doubts in my life. And I remember in 1976, there was a man from Ottawa, a good friend of mine from Ottawa, and we were the last ones to come out of Hay River. And I got this letter from a man by the name of Dale Cummins. And some of you will remember Dale. And Dale was a quiet man. Dale was not a loud, boisterous man, and he was one of our professors at Bible school. And I remember many a times I would come out of Dale's class, and Dale would be weeping, literally crying and weeping over the scriptures. And I remember coming out of his class, and I felt something from that man's tears and that empathy that he had for us as young men and women that really knew nothing about the things of God. And Dale loved us. And in 1976, my life changed forever, because in 1976, Dale wrote me the most precious letter I'd ever received. My father passed away when I was 19 years old. I died of cirrhosis. I didn't know where I was supposed to be. I didn't know where I belonged, and I didn't know who I was. And Dale wrote me this letter of encouragement that I'll never forget, and it changed my life. And you know, one of the great lessons I learned that day is that if I'm secure in who I am and where I belong, it will influence the rest of my life. Let me say that again. That letter taught me that if I'm secure in who I am as one of God's sons, and I'm secure in where I belong, it will affect the rest of my life. And who you are, produces what you will do in every sphere of your life. Who you are and who you belong to will produce in every sphere of your life. It will affect you for the rest of your life. So this morning, there's a beautiful passage in Psalm 139, and I just want to read it for you today. It's verses 13 to 15. For the psalmist says, "For you were formed in my inward parts, and you knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made." And then he goes on to say this: "Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you." Notice this. "And when I was made in the secret place, when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth." You know, when I was looking at that psalm this morning, there's several things that really stands out to me. And I want to share with you this morning while you're in this season of waiting. First of all, I think it's interesting that the psalmist says that we are unique. Did you hear me? We are unique. God, notice this, God created us. God created us in his image. And it's interesting this morning that you have to see yourself from a kingdom mentality, that God has chosen us and he's created every one of us special. You know, you're probably like me when you were growing up. You probably had lots of doubts about who you were, and maybe some doubts about what you were supposed to do in life. And some of you ask questions, you know, what does God want me to do? Does he want me to go into this profession, or does he want me to go into this job or that job? But the Bible tells us that no matter what we do, that we are unique. I like that. And that we don't have to feel discouraged or depressed about who we are or even about what's going on in our lives, or maybe a change in direction that God is taking you on right now. And maybe you're moved out of a job, or you're moved out of a position that you love, and you're feeling discouraged, and you're feeling like, God, will I ever get it right? And what am I supposed to do now? I want you to know that God created you special. And when God created you, he threw away the mold. Isn't that beautiful? That there's only one person like you, and you are created in God's image. I love it. The psalmist says, number one, we're created by God. And then he says, I was fearfully and wonderfully made. And I was woven together. What an interesting way to explain that. I was woven together. In other words, God took great consideration in molding you. And so today I want you to know that you are so unique in how God created you, and that even in this pandemic, in this season of quietness and uncertainty that we live, we can still trust God that he created us in his image, and he created us, listen to this, for such a time as this, just like he did for Esther. You know what else I learned about that passage of scripture and through Dale's letter is that in this uniqueness, I want to stick to the fundamental things in my life. And I want to be brilliant in the common things. You know, the writer says, my soul knows it very well. You know, I realized a long time ago that I'm probably not the best pastor in the world. And I recognized a long time ago that I'm probably not the best preacher in the world. I'm not the greatest theologian. I'll admit that. But I know something, that God has given me some things through my life that I've always tried to keep as the fundamental areas in my life. A good friend of mine in Genesis, back in our church in Indiana, he said to me, in order to be at the pinnacle of your career, you have to be great at the basics. In order to be good at the pinnacle of your career or wherever God has called you, you have to be good at the basics. And you know what? We lose our edge. We lose our edge when we start doubting our call, in our position, in our image that God has created us in. And so I made it important in my life, I've made this a goal in my life, that there are a lot of things that I can't do. There are a lot of things that I'm not equipped to do. I mean, this whole technology that we're learning today, I'm learning on the run. I'm a man in my 60s, and this is a whole new way of communicating to people that I've never done before. And so I'm learning, and it's not that you can't learn, you're just a little slower, but some of the things that I learned years ago, they are the fundamentals in my life. See, I learned that worship was very important in my life. And I want to be, even as the pastor of a church, I want to be a good worshiper. I want to come to God, and I want to be open-handed and open-minded and say, God, I don't have a lot to give you today, but I can give you myself, and I can give you my worship. And I pray that will be a fundamental in your life. Another fundamental in my life is prayer. And I keep that as a fundamental. I don't want to ever get to the place where I think I know how to do this. That is one of my greatest concerns for pastors and young pastors, that my goodness, we have to rely on God every day. Every time I step into the pulpit on Sunday morning, every time I meet with people through the week, I need God in that conversation. I need God in that sermon. I need God in my life as I walk through life every day, and even this morning as I've come to the church and prepared. And so my prayer life is a fundamental. My generosity is a fundamental. Dave Woodcock wants to live a generous life. I want to be a person that gives. I want to give of my resources, and I want to give of my life. You know what else is a fundamental in my life? I love life. I love laughter. I love a good joke. I love being with people. I enjoy being with people. And I would hope that people would enjoy being with me. And you know, these are fundamentals. These are simple fundamentals that we can keep in our lives, that joy and that laughter. You know, some people, they're so hard to be around. In fact, my mother used to call them grace growers because it was always about them. You know, you'd be talking to them, and the whole conversation is about what they're doing and how they're doing it. And they're sometimes that's a lot of insecurities. And I like to be around people that know how to laugh at themselves. I like to be around people that know how to really enjoy the goodness of God and enjoy the everyday things that come at you. I love that laughter. I love being around people that they're easy to be around. And I know I'm around people that aren't easy to be around, but I enjoy being around those special people. And I made my friends that I've made in my life over these last, many decades are people that I really love being around because they make me laugh. And the other thing that is a fundamental to me is encouragement. I also love being around people that know how to encourage you. So the psalmist said, my soul knows it very well, and that I'm going to stick to those fundamentals. But there's one other thing that I've learned in life. And as I realize that I've been created in the image of God, here's the third thing, is that God has created me to engage in the world in which I live. Let me say that again. God has engaged you. He created you to engage in the world in which you live. You say, Pastor Dave, how can I do that now? We're in the middle of a pandemic. Not a lot going on. The streets are bare. I'm not talking to anybody. I'm not sitting around a restaurant. I'm not having fellowship. I'm not breaking bread. I know, I understand that. But with this modern day technology, every one of us have the opportunity to connect and engage in the world that you live. And here's what I've learned out of my insecurities, is that God has blessed me with some gifts. He hasn't blessed me with a lot of gifts, but he's blessed me with some gifts. And like I just said before about the things that I want to do well, those are the things that I want to maximize in my life. Those are the things that I want to stay in my lane with. I don't want to get out of my lane because when I get out of my lane, I get lost. You know, my lane is a pastor. My lane is a lover of people. My lane is an encourager. My lane is a worshiper. My lane is a person that loves Saturday evening prayer and worship. My lane is to be around people. So in the world in which I live, God is telling me to connect and to engage and to maximize the gifts that God has given me. And never to be ashamed of that. And never to feel like you're not doing something great for the kingdom of God. You know, some of the greatest men and women I have met stayed in their lane. And their lane was a lane that the world would say, that's not all that successful. Some of the greatest men and women I have met are pastoring some of the smallest churches I've been in. And I love to go to their churches and just be there. And of course, many times they ask me to come and minister. And I just enjoy being there because as I watch these spiritual sons and daughters, I watch them in a lane that is their lane, and they've taken ownership. You know, I have a precious couple, George and Dottie Ellingwood. They're spiritual sons and daughters of mine, and they're in Providence, Rhode Island. They planted a church 9 years ago, a Genesis church in Providence, Rhode Island. And George is from the East Coast, and he talks like an East Coaster, and he acts like an East Coaster. And Dottie is from down on the river in Indiana. She's not even from Madison, Indiana. She's from Vivi, Indiana. And she has the greatest accent when Dottie opens up her mouth. I mean, it is an Indiana twang, man. It's the most amazing accent. And God marvelously put them together. And about 10 years ago, Dottie was my children's pastor at Genesis Church. And George was what I called one of my cavemen and was on our board, one of my elders, and just loved me and watched over me. And they came to me and they said, do we feel like God is calling us to Rhode Island and to plant a church? And so we prayed with them. We went out there and we helped them start that church. We sent elders out there. And now I go out there and I see they have grown so much. And they've stayed true to who they are. George is still a New Englander. And in many ways, Dottie's still this precious, precious lady. That has such an anointing of God upon her life, and they've never changed lane. They've always tried to stay true to who they are. And it's me as a spiritual father. I go out there, and I'm so blessed. And so I want you to know today that no matter where you're coming from, what side of the tracks you're coming from, doesn't matter how far along you are, when you got saved, whether it was years ago or whether you're just coming into the things of God now, God created you. God created you. And he created you in his image to engage in the world in which you're engaging now. You know, a guy by the name of Howard Thurman, an old theologian, British theologian, he said, don't ask what the world needs. Don't ask what the world needs. Ask what makes you come alive and go do that. Don't ask what the world needs. Ask God what makes you come alive and why don't you go do that? So here's some things I want to leave with you this morning. Number one, whether you're working from home or from your office or whatever you're doing, do your job well. Do your job well. Even if you're working from home, do your job like you're the owner of the company. Do your ministry well. Whether you're ministering from home, on the phone, on Facebook, on Zoom, do your job well and engage well with the community that God has blessed you with. The second thing I want to give to you today is engage with your generosity. Be a generous person. If you have money coming in, if you're still working, it doesn't hurt to go take out your meal once in a while and tip that person. Tip that person that's behind the counter at Swiss Chalet. Tip that person that's behind the counter at Tim Hortons. I stop and get my Timmy's coffee every day. I am so glad to be back in Canada. But tip that person. Engage that person. Engage with your time. Would you do that? Take time out today to engage with God. And take time out today to engage with family. And then take time out to engage with someone that you haven't talked to for a long time. So stay in your lane. Recognize you've been created by the image of God. And take those things that God has given you and engage them in the world in which you're in today. Would you do that? You know, I've really enjoyed these devotional times. They're more relaxed. I feel we're just sitting in a living room talking together. And I thank you for your remarks here on the video projection screen on Facebook and YouTube. And we want you to know that we are praying for you every day at Peace Tower Church. We want you to stay safe and we want you to stay well. And I want to say to our friends that aren't here in Ottawa, I miss you very much, and I'm hoping someday when this pandemic is over, you will come to Ottawa, to the great city of Ottawa, and stay at the Woodcock Hotel, okay? We want you to do that. We have this beautiful townhouse Maureen and I that God has blessed us with three bedrooms, and we want you to come and stay at the Woodcock Hotel, and we're just going to take you around and show you the greatest city in the world. I would have never dreamed I would say that. But Iowa, what an amazing city. It ranks in the top cities of the world and just a beautiful city. And so you come to Ottawa and come to Peace Tower Church and let us bless you. And for our Peace Tower family, oh man, it's good to talk to you today. We are excited. This Sunday morning, we have a special treat for you. And I'm not going to tell you what it is, but we're going to pre-record it. And my birthday's coming up next week, so I've asked a few friends to help me celebrate on Sunday. And so we are going to have a great Sunday morning service. We're going to be showing different videos, and it's going to be a good time. So we look forward to seeing you on Sunday morning. We hope you have a good week. And like I say all the time, would you please stay healthy and stay safe. We love you. God bless you. Maureen and I love you from the bottom of our heart. Have a great day.